Dr. Muehleisen, what was your height and weight as a national four-wall racquetball and paddleball champion?
I'm 6 feet tall and weighed 173 pounds as a racquetball and paddleball tournament player.
Did left-handedness run in your family?
No.
Was being left-handed an advantage in the Haber matches in Memphis, Tennessee and Long Beach, California?
No. Racquet sports players who are left-handed usually have an edge, but it was actually a disadvantage because the Memphis State University four-wall court had a high glass side right wall with improper lighting on the outside. So Haber would hit the handball with his right hand, which was his strongest hand, with what he called a feather touch ceiling ball that, like wallpaper, would hug the side wall and die at the back wall. So it was so hard to pick up visually that many times I whiffed the ball because I couldn't see it good.
How does being left-handed help you at racquetball?
The Haber matches were a freak thing. In playing racquetball, 80% of the time, players would forget and hit or serve to my forehand. One time, I was in the second game of the match, and the opponent got real mad and stopped and said, "I just figured out, you're left-handed." He kept serving to my power.
What games did you play as a child?
I started playing tennis at age 10. I played all the time. In high school, I lettered in tennis, basketball, and baseball. I grew up in San Diego, California, across from a park with 10 tennis courts. I grew up on tennis courts. My favorite childhood memories are growing up and playing tennis with players like national champion Maureen Connolly Brinker, having great parents who love me. I was very fortunate as an only child.
Do you have any disappointments from Memphis and Long Beach?
Tremendous. Not from Long Beach. That was routine. The biggest problem at Memphis was we had not picked a referee, and so the referee was kind of picked out of a crowd. And he really did not know handball rules and did not know what kind of competitor Paul Haber was in his bag of tricks in a competitive game where he did not stick by the rules. And the ref did not know about the lengths of timeouts and did not know about how to control him. And he just took over the control of that match.
Who sponsored you and Haber?
I was sponsored by Ectolan and used the Bud Muehleisen tubular aluminum racket in Memphis. The racket was a lot smaller than the ones on the shelves in stores now for racquetball and tennis, so it had a small sweet spot, and if you miscalculated Haber soft shots or ceiling balls, the racket would turn and almost come out of your hands because of the handball. Haber was subsidized by Robert Kindler.
Where did you practice and play racquetball?
Good question. Prior to playing racquetball, I played paddleball. This was the wooden form of the game. It was a wooden paddle. We started playing that at the Y in San Diego, and seven of us built a private court. A very high-quality private court. So I played paddleball for 7 years, and I had 7 national titles in paddleball before I wrote the rules and started the game of racquetball in 1969. So I had my own private court to play. Prior to that, we played at the local YMCAs.
What were your goals after winning the hands versus racket match in Long Beach?
No immediate goals. I was set on winning in Long Beach because a lot of people had lost money betting on me in the Memphis match. The first goal of these matches with Haber was to promote racquetball and handball. Ben Agajanian, who was a former professional NFL and AFL football place kicker, opened the Long Beach Athletic Club and wanted the second match at his club as part of the grand opening.
Was there anyone within the USHA, IRA, AARA who said that there will not be a third and deciding match based on Haber's win in Memphis and your victory in Long Beach?
No one specific. It was just a consensus that there were too many local guys in clubs around the country playing hands versus racket, getting hurt real bad. It was just so dangerous that we said we are just not going to do that anymore. No other reason.
Did Haber want a third match?
Yes. He was always asking me when, where, how much money do the racquetball people have to wager. I mean, this had really gotten hot in the private clubs, and guys would start doing it, and we did not care about that. But every guy who does it, who does not have a great control, can kill somebody with the handball.
Did you play handball to prepare for Haber?
Yes, I did not like the game because you could not propel the ball. I practiced with former national champions Jimmy Jacobs, Stuffy Singer, and Gordy Pfeiffer in hands versus racket to get ready for Paul, but they really did not have any strategy to beat him because he was the current national champ and had no weakness or Achilles heel. My primary thought was to control the hard handball off the strings of the racquetball racket. It is very hard to control and keep it off the back wall as a setup for Haber. If you hit it hard, the handball just goes around the walls and is killed easily. I learned after losing in Memphis to play like a handball player. In Memphis, I hit the handball too hard. That did not work.
How would you compare yourself and Haber in lifestyle?
I was establishing a dental practice with my father and had a wife and three young children. Racquetball for me was fun, good exercise, and a great camaraderie because I played doubles. Paul Haber drank and smoked a lot. I did not. In fact, I was known as the White Knight and Straight Arrow by the media.
Was Haber hypoglycemic? It has been reported he would guzzle bottles of pure cane sugar outside of handball courts while playing. Did this ailment make him overly combative, which is a symptom of hypoglycemia? What other mental disorders did he have? Was he a fugitive from San Jose, California police for multiple hot checks and avoided arrest by hiding under houses on blocks? Did he criminally trespass into the Olympic Club in San Francisco, California? Archival photographs show him smoking during glove changes at National 3 and 4 Wall Handball Championships and drinking beer outside of the court during tournament matches at the South End Rowing Tournament in San Francisco, California. Is this all true?
I am not aware of any of that. I do know he had been in prison a couple of times for failure to pay child support and being away in arrears on spousal support. He was a scratch golfer. He taught golf in Chicago. Haber played on the PGA Tour. Haber was a super competitor. I was a 9-to-5 dentist and played doubles a couple times each week after work trying to balance my family. I did dentistry at a hospital on the weekend. Haber, for all intents and purposes, was a professional handball player. He did not have a real job. I had around 90 days to prepare for Haber, and when I was in a city for racquetball tournament, I would call Pfeiffer in Washington State or Jacobs in Chicago and play hands versus racket to get ready for Paul in Memphis.
How was your racket strung for Haber?
It was strung less. It gave me more control. The ball was on the strings a little longer. The spread moved around because the handball was so hard, and I used a gut string, not a nylon string.
Did Haber practice against any racquetball players?
Not that I know of.
Why, after Paul's death, years later, did Sports Illustrated focus on Haber having $42 in his pocket, a cat, and some cat food?
The $42 is probably correct. We never saw the $42 when we had to take up money to bury him. You know, that is the media. Paul was his own worst enemy. He burned all of his bridges he got where he could not beg, borrow from people, or pay them back. So when he died, he was penniless and friendless. Know what I mean? He could no longer get any work or job. He was very lazy. He just wanted to play all day long. That is all he wanted to do.
Were there any eyewear rules in 1972 for racquetball and handball?
No. It is hard to believe, but no eye guard rules. Haber wore none, and I wore prescription glasses.
What were Haber's antics prior to the first game in Memphis?
He totally intimidated the referee, Smitty Shippers. He just controlled the match. You were allowed 2 30-second timeouts in a 21-point game. It may have been 3 in 1972. I should know that because I wrote the rules of racquetball. Paul in the second game and third game had 5 20-minute timeouts. He just would not come back in the court. The ref would yell at him, but he would not come back. He would say, "I got a wet glove." He would go get a glove, come back, and lean against the sidewall, start to put the handball glove on, and tear it. He would look up at Smitty and say, "Torn glove," and just leave the court again. He did whatever he wanted to do. He was never warned, if you do not speed up play, you will be given a technical and loss of point. They just did not know what rules to use. Handball rules or racquetball rules. Basically, they are the same for all intents and purposes. Smitty just lost total control of the match. You know my doubles partner, Charlie Brumfield, who played with me for 7.5 years, and we never lost a game, was in Memphis. And he can truthfully tell you, too, what happened. He is a lawyer here in San Diego. The most points ever scored on us were 13 in a finals. Charlie can tell you the points, rallies. His recollection is 10 times better than mine. He was standing up high behind the back wall with the promoter and president of the Memphis Racquetball Association, DeWitt Shy. Shy had on a pinstripe suit.
Did the velocity of the ball on the racket cause Haber to return the handball with more speed?
Yes. Paul hit the feather-touch ceiling ball. It died in the coffin corner. The handball was hit by Paul with a real timing thing. He scooped it. The ball came off the strings of my racket so fast.
Ace Magazine said if you controlled eras, you would win in Long Beach. Would you go along with that?
Absolutely. That is exactly right. Here's some history of racquetball. Is that all right?
Sure.
There was a guy in Connecticut, a tennis pro, Joe Sobek. To stay in shape, when it snowed, he went inside YMCA handball courts and sawed off the end of tennis rackets and took the inside of a tennis ball made by a Pennsylvania rubber company called a Penn's Pinky, and that is the rubber ball that he used. Sportscraft picked up the racket, and all the national paddle players like me called it the wooden clunker. They decided to have a national tournament with this racket because it was only played in Connecticut, Wisconsin. So they would have this strong small racket championship at the JCC in St. Louis in 1969. So Brumfield and me got Sportscraft wooden clunkers and another racket made out of tubular steel, and it had wired strings in it. So we went, and there were state champions, about 250 players, including the women. So we decided we needed to organize the sport, and we went into a room and did not know what to call the sport, so there were names and nominations, paddle rackets, paddle ball, tennis racket, and a tennis pro from California, Bob McInerney, said, "It has a racket and it has a ball, why don't we call it Racquetball?" Time was then spent deciding Racquetball, or Racquetball. We did not want the connotations of the criminal word racket, so we adopted the French spelling, Racquetball. I was put in charge of writing the rules and the specs of the rackets and balls. I helped a bunch of companies develop racquetball products. So that is how it got started. I was 38, Brumfield was 19. I think we were put at opposite ends of the draw and met in the finals, and I won the third game 21-20 of the first National Racquetball Championship. The second year, you had to qualify. I got injured in the qualifying finals and could not play. That summer, Mel Gorman opened the first racquetball handball facility in San Diego, and he hired Paul Haber to run it. At the opening, Haber played Steve August, and I played Bill Schmidtke, who was a national champion, because I had been hurt, and I beat him 8-12 in 21-point games. I was getting much older than everybody. I was 40 years old.
Bob Kindler called the handball versus racquetball matches the fiercest and best mixed match ever held. He said racquetball gained respect. Would you agree?
Did a little for racquetball and tons for handball in regards to respect from the matches. Handball did not gain any more players. Racquetball was having real trouble getting into handball courts because the handballers said the racquet guys damaged the walls. Ruins the walls, marks the walls. The handball players did not want the racquetball players in the courts. What is the most important point was that in the school systems, particularly at the college level and working down to high school, racquetball was so much easier to gain a level of proficiency. The racquetball sections quickly filled up and overtook handball. Handball was a dying thing. Now, it's almost non-existent. The average age of a handball player is probably 60 years old. It is dead almost.
Who was the most bizarre person you played in racquetball?
Bobby Fischer, the chess player in a doubles match at Ambassador College in Pasadena, California. When the media and the world could not locate him, he was a total recluse and did not talk. I was there to put on an exhibition and a clinic.
Was this during racquetball's incredible growth spurt in the 70s?
Yes. Handball was in a spiral of death, and beginners said, "Where has this game of racquetball been? It's fun, easy to learn." 12 million people were playing racquetball by 1979 from when I helped start it in 1969. We were getting ready to put it on TV, and then greed came into racquetball by the suppliers, and they wanted to control the game, so they made the balls faster and faster and faster. Prince bought Ectalon, and they wanted to make their rackets bigger. Once they did that, it became a very, very fast game, so there were less rallies. It took the average Joe out of the racquetball equation, because only 5% of racquetball players ever enter tournaments. The other 95% are the buying public. They'd been having so much fun. I was asked everywhere I went, why was racquetball so popular? And I always said, because it is fun. It was not easy to perfect, but easy to play.
You won the first game in Memphis 21-10. Did you get overconfident?
I really thought I would mop up the court with him in game two. Haber was a fierce competitor. Then he started with his antics. Both his elbows and knees were bleeding at the end. It was unbelievable what the guy went through. He had to stall because he was exhausted. He was soaking wet with sweat and would tell the referee, "Wet shirt," and leave to get a dry t-shirt, and then return and wipe his glove on his thigh, and then say, "Wet glove," and leave the court again to find a new glove in his sports bag outside the door. What does a racquetball referee know about stopping play for wet gloves? There were no rules, there was no nothing. He just kept doing that all the time. Then he would come back and tear the glove putting it on. Stall, stall, stall. He would kick the handball with his front foot from the front of the court to the back and then walk after it like it was a mistake. Stall, stall, stall. Nobody ever did anything. Fierce competitor, but here was a guy who smoked and drank every night, so he had to stall in the match. Great athlete, but dissipated his body into oblivion. It finally killed him.
Who had more double faults in Memphis?
Probably me. I tried to hit it hard sometimes. Haber served with a hop. He would hit an overspin or underspin so that when it came back from the back wall, it would jump to the left. It would hop 2 to 3 feet. You cannot do this with a racquetball. So I had a real concern hitting the ball on the sweet spot of my racket. And then the right side wall was always a blind shot all the time. You cannot even see the ball. Any feather touched along the side like wallpaper, and with my racket, the end of the racket would scrape severely.
What about court hinders, avoidable and unavoidable hinders?
It was horrible in Memphis. I hated it. I mean, he just started calling avoidable hinders, even on match point. The referee, Smitty Shippers, like all racquetball players, never called avoidable hinders. In racquetball, in 1972, they were just not called. Haber would reach back and touch me with his hand. He would just raise his hand if he was in trouble and call hinder. He would not even try for the ball. The second match, we got Stuffy Singer, who had been the 1968 National Handball Champion, to referee, and Paul tried again and again the timeouts, avoidable hinders, and I can hear to this day Stuffy saying, "No, Paul, no, Paul, play." Singer would tell Haber after 30 seconds, "Play." He made him go by the rules. He had control of the match, which was real help to me.
Did you target Haber's left side with your shots?
No. Paul was equal from both sides. One thing that was interesting there were no linesmen in Memphis. So because of all of Haber's diving and close calls, it was always up to Smitty in Memphis. There was no backup or appeal process like in Long Beach with the linesmen, and Paul had a lot of questionable calls because he would dive and was soaking wet. And then with the rallies over, he would call timeout and say, "Wet floor, wet floor." And they would throw down towels. It would take 15 minutes for him to slowly walk around and use his feet and wipe up the floor. Another way of stalling. We had linesmen and the appeal process in Long Beach.
Did Ben Agajanian in Long Beach provide adequate financial compensation for you and Paul?
Ben was a handball player. He put Paul and a woman up in a great hotel, paid for their room, meals, and drinks. Subsidized him in everything else. I got not 1 cent from Ben. I drove the 100 miles from San Diego to the match and drove back that night. Paul got wined and dined. I went to this comedy card rack in September 1972 after the match and bought and mailed a gag card to Ben. It showed this guy saying on the cover, "It has been a pleasure doing business with you." And when you opened it, there was a huge screw going right through his body and his chest. I mean, I did not get anything, and Paul got everything. I mean, he was wined and dined. In Memphis, I would not let anyone know where I was staying because if Paul found out, he would call opponents all night long on the telephone. He had habits like this. He was a beauty. He thought this was funny. He had a bag of tricks that would not quit.
In Long Beach, it was standing room only, 700 seats at $20 a seat, $14,000. In 1972, that was a great financial gate. Agajanian said, "You broke ceiling panels in Long Beach practicing there. Is that true?"
No, I did not practice in Long Beach for the match. I did ask Ben for my money because I found out Paul was getting wined and dined. I was practicing at home. I felt I should be getting whatever he is getting. There was no prize money to the winner or the loser. They flew Haber first class to Long Beach. I mean, Paul had no money. In Memphis, there was as many handball players there as racquetball players, and there was so much money being bet. It was before the match, like in England with the bookies walking around. A lot of betting going on among themselves. Lots of money. $40,000 was a figure one I heard. The money was way down for Long Beach because everybody heard that Haber was going to be on the take and throw the match to get paid off to lose, and also set up a third rubber match in another United States city for opportunities to get cash money. The money really fell off the charts in Long Beach. His own people could not trust him. The handball people. His own group.
Why would Paul Haber not start the match in Long Beach?
He was playing cards for money upstairs, and Kendler, who was his benefactor, had to go talk to him. The fans were going crazy and getting uncontrollable. Another interesting true story that has never been printed or recorded in regards to Long Beach, Jimmy Jacobs, a millionaire through boxing films and whose parents owned a lot of the lakefront property in Chicago, a class act, had agreed to call our match. The day of the match, I was told Stuffy Singer was going to be referee because Jacobs had heard Bob Kendler was flying in for the game and Jacobs would not bow down to Kendler, who was a demigod. Jacobs would not go public about his dislike of Kendler, but he left Long Beach. Jacobs was one of the greatest handball players ever.
Why did you switch from paddleball to racquetball?
It was fun, and I was on the very beginning of a new sport in a leadership role. Nowadays, racquetball is a totally different game. Bigger rackets, faster balls, no long rallies, too dangerous for doubles. The change in equipment has killed racquetball. Killed it. I saw it coming, so I sold the 7 racquetball facilities I owned. The greed of the manufacturers. I got out of my endorsements. Everything. I knew the death of the sport was coming. When the dimension and specifications of the rackets were limited, length, width, the marketing people could not do anything. All they could do was change colors, decals, names, and stuff. Prince was the oversized tennis racket company, and they bought Ectalon. They came out with their oversized racket. We were told if we did not let them produce the oversized racquetball racket, they would pull all their $50,000 sponsorships immediately of players. When they made the racket, C players became A players overnight because they could hit it so hard and the ball got faster and faster. It took the rally out of the game, and it became such a reflex game that 90% of the people buying products quit the game because they were not athletes. They could not reflex and go fast enough. It took the game right out of their hands. I saw it coming. I knew they were killing the game. It is still around, but the John Q. public is not buying racquetball equipment. 1/10 of the 1% is the growth rate today of racquetball compared to the early 70s. The first real inkling that racquetball was going to go bust was a Wall Street Journal article in May 1978. I mean, the equipment changes to make money took the average guy with a set of tennis shoes and sufficient motor skills out of the 3- and 4-wall racquetball courts.
Did you have any illness or injuries in 1972?
I had no injuries in the Memphis games. Haber forced me to play his game in Memphis. You cannot learn overnight how to play with this ball. The handball reacts off the racket so different. If we had been using a racquetball, it would not have been a contest. You could not roll out the ball if you hit it too hard. I needed to pop it more. You know I never hit Haber with the ball. I could have maimed him. Paul knew I was not a dirty player. Haber was as dirty as they come. He played me very tough because he knew I would not kill him with the ball. There were a couple of times I might have hit him if I had continued with the shot. I held up instead. We had agreed before the match that I could hold up. Haber crowded me because he knew I was a clean player.
You actually outscored Haber in the 3 games in Memphis.
Amazing. He actually was winning 17-0 in the 3rd game and got tired. I came back at 20-18, and then with the ball in play, he reached back and hit me on my shirt and stopped play and said, "Avoidable hinder, avoidable hinder. Look at my glove, it's wet." Smitty just wanted out of there, so he said, "Point, game, and match." The guys at the back door busted it down and came in and put Paul up on their shoulders. A lot of guys had won a lot of money.
Was Haber going to be in trouble with organized crime or the mafia if he had lost in Memphis?
No. The gambling was wealthy handball players and the guys in racquetball. There was no underworld, connotation, or affiliation. You know why? Because nobody really knew what was going to happen. I had played and practiced with 5 national handball champions and had toyed with them. They could hardly score a point, but Haber was something else. I should have dinked the ball more and kept it off the back wall more in Memphis. You know, you learn more from losing than winning, so in Long Beach, I played like a handball player and kept the ball in play, hitting it softer and looking for more opportunistic shots instead of just hitting it hard. This was a big help in Long Beach.
What do you know about Haber's family?
I know he was married 2 or 3 times, the last time on a handball court in Las Vegas. Her name was Mary. Haber came up a really hard way in Chicago. We later in life became friends. There was a mutual respect. There was no animosity or hate. I am not that type of person. In both matches, we had no confrontation or problems. We let Smitty and Stuffy handle it all.
What were the typical serve, shot, strategies, and unique memories of the Haber matches?
Here's some interesting general information. The first match was around 3 hours and in Long Beach, 1.5 hours with the same amount of points. A film was done in Memphis of the match by the Memphis State Tiger Photography class. I've never watched it. What happened in Memphis was a nightmare. It was terrible and ugly, freaky, crazy. Haber hit hops that were hard to read as a returner. I used drives, lobs. He served right-handed. I served left-handed. I hit more fly shots because of the reach advantage. He never called a carry on himself or any illegal shot. I had no pressure on me in Long Beach, just a lot of vengeance. I just wanted to use my head more. You know, that match went 3 games, too. Stuffy Singer made him play by the rules. He ran twice as much, and because he could not stall, he got twice as tired. I wore some anti-fog spray on my glasses that I bought at a fair. I could see the ball so much better in Long Beach. We used Z-serves, too. The ball would get lost along the glass in Memphis. Haber had more success hitting the ball back where it came from. It was his game. The only thing I had was more reach and power. It was his game because it was his ball. Haber crowded me all the time because he knew I was Mr. Nice Guy. The media said I was the white knight, straight arrow. The racket I played with against Haber would look like Mutt and Jeff compared to today's racquetball rackets. The big problem was the handball. It was black and hard. I was a fish out of water because it was Haber's ball. My power advantage did not make a big difference. It is like softball and hardball baseball. The swing is different in the two games, and the balls are totally different. This was the biggest loss of my life. I really never lost anything at paddleball, tennis, or racquetball, but the Haber match was not racquetball. It was racquetball played with a handball. It was a circus thing that is what it was. Paul and I showed up, and there was no referee in Memphis. I said, who's going to call it? Finally, the promoter and Smitty with me and Paul went in a non-glass show court, and we all said, what are we going to do here? Paul was vehement about how things were going to be, and he began manipulating DeWitt Shy and Smitty Shippers. We never discussed wet gloves, torn gloves, and timeouts, how long, wiping up the floor. All that was stated was we would play by the rules because the two sports are virtually the same. Except for Paul and his timeouts and stalling stuff, there were no rules for that. Paul wrapped the referee around his finger. I made sure in Long Beach that this would not happen again, and Stuffy Singer, a handball player, knew all about Paul's antics. Smitty was not competent and was just a local guy who was a big buddy of DeWitt Shy. Here's a funny story from Memphis. To spotlight racquetball, I was in a doubles competition 10 minutes after the Haber match because I thought this was going to be more of a challenge, and had scheduled it figuring Haber was just another handballer. I cramped up and had to stop the racquetball doubles game. All the handball fans had left the gallery. Haber was a piece of work at Memphis State University. It was a real circus, a total circus. It was the most exciting event I had ever attended.